I came across this amazing new factoring method that you've probably never seen before. If you watch to the end of this video, you'll be able to factor absolutely any type of quadratic expression without having to guess and check any values for your product and sum. Let me show you how we can factor the standard form quadratic, x squared plus 32x plus 192, without having to do any guessing and checking. Now, when your teacher first taught you how to factor this type of quadratic trinomial, that has an a value of 1, a b value of 32, and a c value of 192, your teacher probably taught you that you can split this quadratic into two factors, where in each of those two factors, they start with an x, and then you would have to do some sort of guessing and checking until you could figure out what numbers you add to each of those x's to make this product equal that standard form quadratic. Now, you wouldn't just guess and check any random numbers. You probably learned that these numbers, let's call them m and n, those values of m and n always have a sum of the b value, so in this case, 32, and they also have a product of the c value, 192. And at this point, you would probably start guessing and checking until you can find the pair of numbers, m and n, that satisfy this product and sum. And how students in my class usually do this is they start focusing in on the product, and they think of what numbers multiply to 192. Well, 2 times 96 is 192, but 2 plus 96 is not 32, so 2 and 96 don't work. And then students keep guessing and checking numbers that have a product of 192 until they find the ones that also have a sum of 32. So maybe they would scroll through a few more options until they actually find them. So they could try 4 times 48, that's also 192, but those don't add to 32. And 12 and 16 multiply to 192, but they don't add to 32. And you can see how this guessing and checking can get time consuming, and it really relies on students being good at knowing the factors of 192. So there has to be a better way where we don't have to go through this guessing and checking. Let me show you that. So let's erase all of this, and let's find those product and sum numbers without having to guess and check anything. And how we're going to do that, we're going to focus instead on the sum being 32. Well, half of 32 is 16. So for that reason, I know two 16s added together would be 32. And in fact, any numbers that have a sum of 32, the average of those numbers is going to have to be 16 so that when they're added together, we get 32. So for example, 15 plus 17 is also 32. Notice 15 is one less than 16 and 17 is one more than 16. And if I continue this pattern, 14 plus 18 would also be 32. 14 is 2 less than 16, and 18 is 2 more than 16. So the two of those numbers have an average value of 16, which is why when we add them together, we get double 16, which is 32. And let me write one more sum so just you get this principle. 13, which is 3 less than 16, if I add that to a number that's 3 more than 16, which is 19, I'll get 32. So to find a sum of 32, the two numbers that I pick, one of them's going to be less than 16 and one of them's gonna be greater than 16, but the distance that they are from 16 is going to be equal to each other. So I could write a general rule for any two numbers that have a sum of 32. I could say that 16 minus some constant plus 16 plus that same constant would have to equal 32. As long as I move the same amount below 16 and above 16, I know that the sum of those two numbers is going to be 32 because the average of these two numbers is going to be 16. And now that we have this general rule, where we could say 16 minus c is our m value and 16 plus c is our n value, I know that these two values, m and n, have to have a product of 192. So I can set up that product. 16 minus c times 16 plus c has to be equal to 192. And now I just have to solve for that constant c. This product is a difference of squares. So following the difference of squares formula, I would have 16 squared minus c squared is equal to 192. Well, 16 squared is 256. And if I isolate c squared, 256 minus 192 is 64. And then to solve for c, I could do plus or minus the square root of 64. So there are technically two answers to this. The square root of 64 is 8. So our two answers are plus or minus 8. But we actually don't need both of these answers. We only need one of them. No matter whether we subbed in positive 8 or negative 8 in for c into these two factors, we'll end up with the same two values for m and n, just in a different order, and the order doesn't matter. So why don't we just take the positive square root of 64 to make our answer for c 8. And if c is 8, if I sub it into this expression for the sum of the two numbers that equal 32, I would have 16 minus 8 plus 16 plus 8 equals 32, which means we have 8 plus 24 equals 32, which it does. 8 plus 24 is 32. So this m value of 8 and this n value of 24 has the right sum, it adds up to 32, but do they also have the right product? Well, if I check, 8 times 24 is 192. So we were able to get those right numbers, 8 and 24, that have the right product and sum without having to do any guessing and checking. So to write the final factored form, I just take this m and n value and replace the m and n in the factored form that I have written here. So my final answer is just x plus 8 times x plus 24. Now, having seen this method for the first time, hopefully you were able to follow it and gain a bit of an appreciation for how intuitive and amazing this method is for being able to get this quadratic into factored form without having to do any guessing and checking for product and sum numbers. But you might be a little bit skeptical. This quadratic was set up fairly easily to be able to work well with this method. But I guarantee you, this method actually works to factor any quadratic expression. Even quadratics where the a value is not 1, and also quadratics that are going to have irrational or imaginary numbers in their factors. So keep watching till the end, and I'll show you all of those different types of quadratics, and we'll see how this method works for all of them. You'll be able to factor absolutely any quadratic without any guessing and checking by the end of this video. So let's try another example. Here's another fairly straightforward one, just to get you comfortable with the method. We're going to factor the quadratic x squared minus 6x minus 91. Once again, we have an a value of 1, b value of negative 6, c value of negative 91. I know this is going to be able to split into two factors. Each of those factors will start with an x, and to each of those x's, I'm going to add two values. We'll call them m and n, but we're going to have to do some work to find m and n. Because the quadratic has an a value of 1, I know that m and n will have a sum of the b value, so they'll add to negative 6, and they'll have a product of the c value, negative 91. And now get out of the habit of guessing and checking numbers that multiply to negative 91 and then trying to find ones that also have that sum. We're going to instead start by thinking about this sum. In order for numbers to have a sum of negative 6, I know those two values, m and n, are going to have an average value that is half of negative 6. So they're going to have an average value of negative 3. In order for two numbers to have an average of negative 3, I could add some constant to negative 3 to get my first number, as long as my second number is that same distance c, but less than negative 3. So I would have to subtract c from my second number. And because each of these values are an equal distance, greater than negative 3 and less than negative 3, I know that when I add them together, they're going to equal negative 6. Let me just shrink that a bit. And now that I can associate negative 3 plus c with m and negative 3 minus c with n, I know I want those m and n values, these two values here, to also have a product of negative 91. So I can set up that product. And then this is a difference of squares. It would equal 9 minus c squared if I expanded it. Isolating c squared, on the left I'll have 9 plus 91, which is 100, equal to c squared. And then I just need one solution to this equation, so I'll just get the positive square root of 100, which is 10. Now that I know that c is 10, I can sub it back into these two equations to make sure it satisfies my product and sum correctly. Into this sum equation, I would have negative 3 plus 10 plus negative 3 minus 10 is equal to negative 6, which means my two numbers are 7 and negative 13. When I add those, I do get negative 6. And if I multiply them, if I do 7 times negative 13, I do get negative 91. So I have found my correct product and sum numbers, 7 and negative 13, without having to do any guessing and checking. I just take these two values and replace m and n with them, and then I have my correct factored form. So the factored form is x plus 7 times x plus negative 13, which we would just write as x minus 13. Now let's try one that's a little bit more difficult. You'll notice in the first two examples, the sum that we wanted, when I took half of that number, I was able to get an integer value instead of a fraction. Let's see what happens if we get a fraction when we find half of the number we want to sum of. Let's say we want to factor the quadratic expression x squared plus 9x plus 20. This quadratic still has an a value of 1, has a b of 9, and a c of 20. Because of the a value of 1, I know it's going to factor to two factors that both start with x, and I'll have to find the two numbers that I add to those x's, we'll call them m and n, so that this factored form equals the standard form. Now I know m and n have to have a sum of the b value, 9, and they have to have a product of the c value, 20. Now the numbers that satisfy this product and sum are actually pretty obvious that it's 4 and 5 that work. But let me show you how the algorithm I've taught you will work for this as well. We start by focusing in on the sum, and I know that if two numbers have a sum of 9, the average of those two numbers has to be half of 9, which I could write as 9 over 2. So my m value could start at 9 over 2, and I could add any constant I want to that, as long as for my n value, I subtract that same constant from 9 over 2. So that these two numbers have an average value of 9 over 2, so that when I add them, I get 9. Shrink that a bit. And now I know since these are my m and my n, I know they have to have a product of 20. And then expanding this product, I will get 9 over 2 squared minus c squared. 9 over 2 squared is 81 over 4. If I isolate c squared, I've got 81 over 4 minus 20. I could rewrite 20 as 80 over 4. And 81 over 4 minus 80 over 4 is 1 over 4. And then c would be equal to the square root of 1 over 4. The square root of 1 is 1, and the square root of 4 is 2. So my c value is a half. Take this c value and sub it into my sum and my product equation to make sure I have found the correct values of m and n. Starting with the sum equation, if I sub in my c value of a half, I have 9 over 2 plus a half plus 9 over 2 minus a half. 9 over 2 plus 1 over 2 is 10 over 2, which is 5. And 9 over 2 minus 1 over 2 is 8 over 2, which is 4. So 5 plus 4 is 9. And if I check the product, of course, 5 times 4 is 20. So I have the correct sum and the correct product. So I can just take those values and replace m and n with it, which means my factored form is x plus 5 times x plus 4. Now that we've done three examples where the a value is 1, let's try an example where the a value is not 1 so you can see how it works. Let's factor the quadratic 2x squared minus 7x minus 4. Notice the a value of this quadratic is not 1, but the factoring method I've been showing you only works for quadratics that have an a value of 1. So what we have to do is start by common factoring out this 2 from all three terms of this quadratic. So I'll remove a common factor of 2, and then I'll divide all three terms by 2, giving me x squared minus 7 over 2x minus 2. This quadratic has an a value of 1, a b value of negative 7 over 2, and a c value of negative 2. So because the a value is 1, I know I'm going to be able to split that quadratic into two factors, where each of the factors starts with an x. I'm just going to have to figure out what are the m and the n values that I add to those x's. And I know that the sum of m and n has to be equal to the b value of negative 7 over 2. And the product of m and n has to equal the c value of negative 2. And I'll start by focusing on the sum. I know that the sum of two numbers could be negative 7 over 2, as long as those two numbers both start at half of negative 7 over 2, which is negative 7 over 4. And to the first one, I can add any constant I want, as long as to the second number in my sum, I subtract that same constant. That will make the sum still be negative 7 over 2. And now that I know that these are my m and my n values, I can set my product of those two equal to negative 2. And then in this equation, if I expand the left side of it, I would get 49 over 16 minus c squared equals negative 2. And then isolating c squared, I'd have 81 over 16 equals c squared, which means c is the square root of that, which is 9 over 4. Now that we have the c value, we can solve for m and n by subbing into these two expressions. After subbing in, I find out that my two numbers are a half and negative 4. A half plus negative 4 is negative 3.5. And checking my product, a half times negative 4 is negative 2. So we have the correct m and n values. So I can write my correct factored form. My final answer is just 2 times x plus a half times x plus negative 4, which we would just write as x minus 4. And for your factors to be fully simplified, you shouldn't have any fractions in your factors. So what we can do is distribute this 2 to that first factor to take care of that problem, which would give us 2x plus 2 times a half is 1. So 2x plus 1 times x minus 4. There's our final factored form of this quadratic, and there is no guessing or checking necessary. Let's now have a look at this quadratic, x squared plus 8x plus 4. This quadratic has an a value of 1, b value of 8, c value of 4. If you were going to try and factor this, we know we could split this into two factors, where because the a value is 1, each of these factors will just start with x, but then we have to figure out what m and n values need to be added to those x's to get it into factored form. Well, remember the m and the n would have to add to the b value, and they would have to multiply to the c value. And this is another great example of why this method is so good. Because if you were to try and guess and check numbers that have a product of 4 and a sum of 8, there are no integers that work. So your teacher would probably tell you just to write that this quadratic is not factorable. But we can actually get it into factored form using this method. Mind you, within the factors, we're going to have some irrational numbers, but that's fine. We will be able to get it into factored form. We start by looking at the sum of 8. And I know two numbers will have a sum of 8. If both of those numbers start at half of 8, which is 4, and then as long as I add and subtract the same amount from each of those 4s, the sum will still be 8. Make this a bit smaller, and then we'll focus on our product being 4. Since my product has to be 4, I know that 4 plus c times 4 minus c is going to have to be 4. And then I can solve this equation. If I expand this product, it's a difference of squares. It would be 4 squared, which is 16, minus c squared. 16 minus 4 is 12, so 12 is equal to c squared, and c would equal, we'll just get the positive square root of 12, which could be split into root 4 times root 3, but the square root of 4 is 2, so I could simplify this to 2 root 3. Now that I have my c value, I can write my sum and product with those c values subbed in to check and make sure it works. Since we have found the numbers that satisfy both the sum and the product, I can take those numbers for m and n and replace the m and the n in my factored form with them. And there's my factored form of this quadratic. And let me give you one more final example where we have a quadratic that we can only factor using imaginary numbers. Let's look at this quadratic, x squared plus 4x plus 10. The a value is 1, b is 4, c is 10. Because the a value is 1, I'll be able to split this into two factors where each of those two factors start with an x. But I'm going to have to figure out the m and the n values that I add to those x's to get it into factored form. I know that the m and the n values have to add to the b value, 4, and they have to multiply to the c value, 10. If you tried to guess and check numbers that satisfy this product and sum, you'd probably give up pretty quickly and just say that this quadratic's not factorable. But we in fact can get it into factored form. Let me show you how. We'll focus on the sum. The sum would be 4. If I add two numbers that both start at half of 4, which is 2, but to each of those two numbers, I have to add and subtract the same amount, and that will ensure that the sum stays at 4. Shrink that. And now that I have my m and my n values, I can make those have a product of 10. I'll expand the left side of this equation to give me 4 minus c squared, which means that negative 6 equals c squared. And then we'll only consider the positive square root, which means c equals the square root of negative 6, which we can actually write as a product of the square root of negative 1 and the square root of 6. And the square root of negative 1, we have a symbol for that. We could just use the symbol I to represent the square root of negative 1. Now that I have my c value, I can determine what my m and my n values are that have the correct sum and product. So I have found the m and the n values that have the correct product and sum. So I'll just sub them in for m and n, and then I have my factored form equation. All right, hopefully you've enjoyed this video, and you now have a new method for factoring any quadratic without having to spend any time guessing and checking values for your sum and your product. Leave me a comment letting me know if you've ever seen this method before, And also, make sure to show your teachers this method. I'm sure they'll appreciate it.
Jensen!